This Is Your Life, this, the boat show at London's Earl's Court, and I'm looking for a face in the crowd. This face. It's somebody I've never met, but I'm very anxious to meet. How would you like to meet him, too? And I'll tell you why he's here and why I'm looking for him here. He has just received another award for gallantry for the rescue of lives in that tragic helicopter crash off the Isles of Scilly in July last year when 20 people died. His bravery has had international recognition. He's been known in connection with the notorious Torrey Canyon disaster, with the catastrophic Fastnet race and the gales of 1979. Many people owe their lives to him, to my face in the crowd. That's him, I'm sure, heading in this direction. Excuse me, Matt.
Yeah.
Matt Lethbridge, yes?
Yeah.
I've been looking for you all over the boat show.
Oh, bloody hell.
So that I could mark this year, I've got the present for you, the year before your retirement from the lifeboat service, because Matt Lethbridge, cox of St. Mary's Lifeboat, the City Isles tonight, This Is Your Life. We went ahead for our television theater where we're ready to launch this story. We've got a car waiting outside, and so that the 11th of January, 1984, this Wednesday, 1 week ahead of your birthday, will be a day you won't forget. Thank you, Admiral. Thank you, everybody, for helping us. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Tell them what you said when I came up to you there. They didn't hear, did they? You didn't really cotton on to what was happening for a few minutes.
No, I didn't. No way.
Didn't recognize me, and then you saw.
Well, dear, I recognized your face, and I thought, I know that face, but it didn't register.
And then you saw the book.
Yeah, that's what registered.
Well, Matt, right away, let me reunite you with the lady from whom you've been inseparable for the last 35 years and who's making a rare visit to London with you, your wife, Pat. Well, Pat, thanks for keeping the secret so well, but you haven't been alone in that, have you?
No, it's been quite a job, but I think there are lots more on the islands that have kept it as well.
Yes, people very close to you need, and closer than you think. A relief crew has taken over at the island, St. Mary's, the largest of the Isles of Scilly, 28 miles of treacherous sea off the coast of Cornwall. And the longer-serving members of your own crew on the lifeboat, the Robert Edgar, are here tonight. Roy Guy, Bill Barrow, and Rodney Kelly. Well, Matt, with you at the helm, these are the pals who've been with you for so many of your 26 years of risking your life to save the lives of others in the merciless seas off the Isles of Scilly. Now, tonight's award at the boat show was in recognition of your action on July 16th last, when tragedy struck a helicopter on a routine daily flight carrying holidaymakers and island residents from the mainland to St. Mary's, and in dense fog plunged into the sea with loss of 20 lives. But six people managed to escape just before the helicopter sank completely. With visibility virtually nil, you launch your lifeboat and steer through the swirling fog, not knowing if there could be any survivors at all in that black and freezing ice-cold sea.
But I shouted to the others at the top of my voice, Matt and the boys will be coming. They'll come and save us.
She was flying back home to St. Mary's when the helicopter crashed. One of those survivors you rescued, Lucy Langley Williams. Lucy, your faith in Matt was clearly justified, and when he arrived on the scene, it really was only a question of moments between life or death, wasn't it?
Yes, Eamon. We'd been in the water for nearly an hour, and one of the survivors was desperately ill. And I'll always remember when the lifeboat came out of the fog, I looked up, and Matt was up on his bridge, and he was looking down at us with all the care and concern in the world on his face, and I just looked up at him and said, oh, Matt.
Well, Matt... Matt, that other survivor was another islander who's been under medical supervision since and rarely leaves her home.
But nothing would stop me being here tonight, Matt, to say thank you for my life.
From her home on the island of St. Agnes, Megan Smith. Well, now, Megan, unable to swim in those seas, Lucille's strength and your own fast running out, it really must have been an incredible moment when Matt's boat loomed up through the fog.
I can only describe it as a miracle, Eamon, because I was unconscious, actually, when Matt came, but I can only say thank you, Matt, for saving my life.
Thank you, Megan Smith and Lucy Langley Williams. Roy Guy, tell us just how did Matt set about finding those survivors in that thick fog?
He seems to have an uncanny sense of where he's going, and like a built-in radar. And he pulled all the stops out, and it was successful.
And Pat, whatever courage and daring is demanded of Matt and his crew here, he always reckons it's the women waiting at home who have the worst of it, right?
Well, I suppose they know what they're doing, but we're just on waiting and wondering what's going on, and that's the difference, isn't it?
Well, Matt, not sitting and waiting at home tonight are two more women very important in your life, and they're here too. Your daughter's Lucy, and with her husband Bob, your elder daughter, Jean. And Jean, mentioning the ladies in Matt's life, there's someone we just can't leave out, right?
Yes, she's the apple of Dad's eye, Eamon.
Well, Matt, take a look at that screen there. You'll see she wasn't going to be left out tonight. Jean's daughter and your only grandchild. She's only 6 months old, little Gemma. The apple of your eye. And Jean, wasn't there a time, and Gemma really is lovely, you told me that in the car coming along here, a time when you were a little girl, when your father really proved to you how brave he was after you'd been frightened by a cow, wasn't it?
It was, Amy. I'd been frightened by this cow, and I'd woke up frightened in the night. I'd been dreaming that it was standing at the bottom of the bed. And Dad came in and said, no, it was all right, there was nothing there. But I would insist that this cow was at the bottom of the bed, and Dad had to literally shoo it out the bedroom. So he really was a hero that night.
You got rid of the cow.
He did, yes.
Well, Matthew Lethbridge, this is your life, and you were born on January 20th, 1924, into a family of lobster fishermen who were also coxswains of the St. Mary's lifeboat. In fact, you're the third generation of Lethbridges to be at the helm, taking over from your late father in 1956. And there he is, Matt Sr., who was awarded the British Empire Medal, and how proud he would have been to know that in 1975, you too were to be similarly honored, Matt. The sea, then, very much in your blood, even at the age of 8, and there you are as a Sea Scout. And it's at that age. Why does it make you smile, Matt?
What's the beauty, isn't it?
Well, it's at that age that you pester your father to go lobster catching with him. though you know he leaves the house at daybreak, and you and your brother must get up in time. The big day arrives.
And I was partly pushed out of bed with you shouting, "Wait up, wait up, I think we've missed the boat."
Your brother Harry, and with him his wife Pamela, and with his wife June, your younger brother Richard. Well, Harry, today you're a member of Matt's crew, and Richard, you were too on for quite recently. But, Harry, tell us about the young Matt waking you up in such a desperate panic that morning.
Well, Eamon, it was like this. We wanted to go to fishing. Dad wouldn't make up his mind whether he'd wake us or not, so we decided to stay away. Well, naturally, we fell asleep. Matt, digging me, says, "Come on, it's daylight." Well, we crept downstairs, went out the backyard, sea boots under the arms. My voice looked out from the window and he said, "Where the hell are you going this time of the morning?" "Get back in bed." He said, "It's 1 o'clock. It was bright moonlight. We thought it was daylight. But he did wake us and then we went.
Good. And Richard, I understand that your brother Matt here is quite superstitious, yeah?
Yeah, I think pretty much really, as all fishermen are, in all fairness, they're... At the beginning of each season, Matt likes his daughter Lucy to go down and put at least one brushful of paint on the fishing boat, the JML.
Now, Matt, can you tell us why you like her to do that?
Well, Dad started it, actually, when Jean was small, and I was down painting the boat one day, and Dad come down with her in... Oh, she was about, what, 2, I should think, 18 months, and she was... He had her in his arms, and he said, "Go, my love, put on a bit of paint for luck." So she, you know, got all her hand with the brush and dabbed this paint. And, well, I've been afraid to stop ever since.
Well,
so one of them has done it. They took it in turns, you know. Both Jean and Lucy have took it in turns.
Great. Matt, you were only 18 when you joined the wartime RAF, not surprisingly in the Air Sea Rescue Division, serving first in British coastal waters, then West Africa. And back home 4 years later, in 1946, you follow in your father's sea boot steps, become a lobster fisherman, and join the crew of the lifeboat. Now, you meet Pat at a local dance, though, of course, you'd been at the same school, Pat.
Yes, we grew up together, really, but it was after the war when we sort of first got went out together then.
After the war and after the dance. And Matt, you start going out with Pat, and you're married on December the 27th, 1949, at the United Methodist Chapel on St. Mary's. 7 years later, you take over from your father as coxswain of the lifeboat. And Matt, when you're not at sea, a hobby of yours is painting, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And of course, your favorite subject, I think, is boats, yes. Your own lifeboat, the Robert Edgar. And there she is. Now, that's very good. How long did it take you to do that?
Actually, that one only took 3 evenings, about 6 hours.
Really?
7 hours, yeah.
So this is a great gift. Did you study or just happened on it?
No, I used to like drawing and painting when I was going to school, and I'd never done it no more for years. And I suddenly thought, well, June does quite a bit of painting, and I thought I would try this oil painting business. I just tried it.
Well, you obviously love the boat. Matt, the first time you saw international headline-making action was in 1967 when the Liberian-registered oil tanker, the Torrey Canyon, went aground on the rocks at Seven Stones off St. Mary's in one of the world's most notorious shipping disasters, because the cargo of crude oil was discharged fouling beaches the length of the English Channel. And there's your lifeboat, Matt, caught on film there, going alongside the Torrey Canyon, urgently getting the crew to safety before the remaining cargo of oil was exploded and the ship sank. The same year, Matt, in May 1967, it's the homecoming of the round-the-world yachtsman Sir Francis Chichester, and Independent Television sends a reporter and technical team to take a look at conditions to prepare for the live coverage. Their chartered yacht, the Braemar, is 30 miles off the Scilly Isles in thrashing seas, and water starts to pour into the engine room. The Braemar's SOS is picked up at Land's End radio station and actually recorded on the spot at the time. This is the message that results in you launching the lifeboat.
Braemar. Braemar. This is Land's End Radio.
St. Mary's lifeboat launching to your assistance. Date time route 220640, over.
Okay, tell him okay. Message received and understood.
Matt, you'd no idea it was the beginning of a non-stop rescue battle that was to take a staggering total of 27 hours and save the lives of the 19 people aboard, the television team and the ship's crew. Now, the cameras were turning as the reporter Richard Lindley described events that day just before you came into view.
Past six this morning, what seemed a series of annoying failures, the radar had gone, the port engine was out, suddenly turned into a dangerous situation. We began making water in the engine room with no means of pumping it out. We spent the last 2 hours trying to rig auxiliary pumps to get the water away. But so far we've not succeeded, and indeed there's no other method left to us. We've even tried the fire pumps and they're not working too. So water continues to gain on us in the engine room, and we've had to send a mayday call.
2206 4 hour.
Okay, tell him okay. Message received and understood.
Message was indeed received and understood, and you completed the rescue, and four members of that grateful television crew are here tonight. Peter Bond, Alan Tingay, Peter Cullen, and Bill Smith. All pals of ours. Your superhuman efforts that day earn you the first of three silver medals from the RNLI, and you have to go to London for the presentation with a little reluctance because you never like to leave that island of yours. And you almost weren't coming this time either.
No, I didn't, no.
You were surprised at the persuasion you were getting to go and collect the award from Admiral Graham.
It does now. It didn't at the time, obviously, but...
And Lucy, I know that you put him under some pressure, he was telling me, but the time we're talking about, you're only 7 years old, but as a special treat, you were taken to London to see your dad receive that medal, right?
Yeah. The main thing I remember was on the day of the presentation, it was very cold, and the newspaper photographers wanted to have a picture of Dad pointing the boats on the Thames to me. So they sat me on a stone wall, and I wasn't very impressed with the length of time they were taking, so I complained to him that I was getting a cold bum.
Well, Matt, the night of February 21st, 1970 was to see a truly astonishing rescue by yourself and your crew here. At 4:45 a.m., you answer a mayday distress call. The Swedish cargo ship, the Norda Anhav, was in desperate peril in mountainous, gale-lashed seas north of the Scilly Isles. Its cargo had broken free, playing havoc with the ship's balance. When you reach the stricken vessel, one moment the waves hurl her 15 feet high above you, the next moment she's plunged below you, your lifeboat rolling on her submerged deck. Now, Roy, how would you describe the conditions?
Hell let loose, I should think, best way. And Matt really put her alongside that time, and it seemed an age, and she was bouncing about 20, 30 feet off. And it seemed an age that we were there, but it was only about 5 minutes, and we had him, and we were away.
Well, Matt, you used the swell of the crashing waves, as Roy described there, to lift you alongside the Swedish ship and let it take you away again, coming back again and again, each time you and your crew grabbing one of the 10 Swedish sailors from whom time was fast running out.
And you kept coming back alongside us until every one of us was safely on board your lifeboats.
Captain of the Nordanha, we've flown him from Gothenburg tonight, Niels Nielsen.
Do you remember in the cabin on the way back, this boat, and our boat was rolling around, you know, and he was sat on the seat, I think it was the carpenter, did you have a carpenter?
Well, no, he hasn't got much English with him.
Well, he called me, and he said, the captain... He wants to know if your boat go over, she come back.
Yeah.
I said, no, if our boat go over, she stay over. I've seen his face.
Captain Nielsen, what's your memory of that night? His marvelous seamanship saved your lives. Thank you, Captain Niels Nielsen.
Well, Matt, that rescue earned you your second silver medal, but sadly you don't always triumph over your old and unpredictable adversary, the sea. For instance, the rescue attempt which resulted in your third silver medal left no survivors. Bill Burrow, you witnessed your coxswain's battle that day in May 1978 when the little French fishing boat, the Enfant de Bretagne, was smashed onto the rocks near Bishop Rock Lighthouse.
Yes, I did, Eamon. We were basically led into the rocks by the smell of fuel oil, and with parachute flares in it, located them, the bow of the trawler, up on a rock in the western rocks. Matt made the approach, and we saw three men, or possibly two, waving and shouting on the bow of the boat. And we went in. A big sea followed us in and lifted us and put us right in over the rocks. And I believe, but for Matt's great knowledge of those rocks, we would have perished ourselves that night.
Getting so close to those seamen and not getting them, how did Matt feel? How did you feel?
We were very, very despondent and upset for quite a long time afterwards, especially Matt.
Well, Matt, the sea again claimed its victims the following year in 1979 when some of the world's finest yachtsmen ran into unexpectedly savage conditions in one of the toughest offshore races in the world. Gales whipped up waves to a height of 30 feet during the fastnet race off Round Island, one of the Scillies, wrecking so many racing craft. And at the end of that tragic day, 19 lives had been lost, one of them washed overboard from the racing yacht, the Festina Tertia. At 7:30 that evening, the skipper radios for help. You'd just returned to port, drenched, cold, and hungry, after being out rescuing two other yachts since 3 that morning.
But Matt, we'll never forget you turned straight round again and headed back to get us.
Skipper of that third stricken yacht with his grateful crew, Neil Mooney. What did it mean to Matt and his crew to go back for you?
Well, having spent 21 hours out rescuing other yachts, they turned straight round and spent a further 3 hours in rescuing us.
Now, Matt, we heard earlier from two other grateful people, Lucille and Megan here, how you rescued from the helicopter disaster in which 20 people died in July of last year. On board that helicopter were holidaymakers who, over the years, had returned every year to your island, which they'd come to love. They'd also got to know and love you, Matt. Especially the children. Now, two children were orphaned in that tragedy, and it was you who plucked them from the sea. 15-year-old Ellen Hanslow and a youngster who lost his whole family, parents, brother and sister, 12-year-old Howard Goddard. Now, the aunts and uncles, who are now their guardians, had absolutely no hesitation in telling us. Those two children would never forgive them or us if they weren't here to express their thanks in person. And they are here. The two young lives you saved that day. Ellen Hanslow and Howard Goddard. Ellen, you were quite close to Lucille in the water, weren't you?
Yes.
And did you hear her?
Yeah, I heard her say that Matt would come and save us. Mm-hmm.
Now, Howard, that wasn't the first time you met Matt.
No, I've known Matt for my holiday since I was a small boy, and I just knew Matt would come. Thank you, Matt.
And thank you, Howard and Ellen. One last thing, Matt. A look at a family photograph taken nearly 50 years ago. Now, that's you, isn't it, on the left? Where are you, Richard?
In the middle.
In the middle. So, Harry, that's got to be you on the right. But that's not the whole picture, because there we see your late parents and one other. Who's that standing next to your father?
This brother, George.
That's right. The fourth and eldest Lethbridge brother who left the islands 34 years ago and emigrated to New Zealand. And, Matt, you haven't seen one another from that day to this, and I do mean this, because although he's only just recovering from an operation which meant the loss of a leg, he wasn't going to miss this amazing reunion. We've flown them from his home in Auckland 34 years on, your brother George.
Matt Lethbridge, Lifeboat hero, this is your life.